Thanks for joining us for the latest episode in SIFMA's DEI podcast series. I'm Jenny Jacoby, Managing Director and Associate General Counsel at SIFMA. Today, I'm speaking with Bryan Gill, Global Head of Neurodiversity, about JPMorgan Chase's commitment to diversity and inclusion and their efforts to recruit and retain neurodiverse colleagues in the financial services industry. Bryan, welcome.
Thank you. Pleasure to be here.
Thanks so much for joining us. So Bryan, to start us off, can you share a little about yourself, your career, and how you found yourself in your current role?
Yeah, no, thanks. So I'm a 30-year veteran of financial services, about 20 years with JPMorgan. Most of my time with JPMorgan I spent in the commercial bank in operations. I had the unique opportunity about 5 years ago to work as a volunteer, as an operations executive, to do a viability study on how JPMorgan Chase could employ colleagues from the IDD community, so intellectually and developmentally disabled, as an extension of our neurodivergent hiring, into our firm in a way that was aligned with our culture and values. And I spent some time with some amazing other employers, Walgreens and Bank of America, to name a few, to understand how that model worked. We built a model and turned it over to our HR operating committee, and they agreed that it was an amazing opportunity for us. And the outcome was that is they posted the job for someone to have the privilege to lead that initiative. And I applied and was fortunate to have been given that opportunity. So 4 years ago, I started what we call the business solutions team, which is that expansion of our neurodivergent hiring.
Wow. Bryan, so as an industry, we talk a lot about our commitment to improving diversity and inclusion efforts, but oftentimes it just feels like the inclusion of neurodiverse employees gets sadly overlooked. How do you define neurodiversity in the workplace, and what are some of the things JPMorgan Chase is doing to create a more inclusive environment?
Yeah, that's a great question. So the first way I define neurodiversity is superpowers and a competitive advantage for our firm. So the fact that I am the global head of neurodiversity for JPMorgan, and the fact that we have a head of neurodiversity is a statement about our commitment to this space. It's a competitive advantage for our firm. These are communities that we want to serve and bank, right? We want clients, certainly clients. Mm-hmm. If you think about in context of kind of the universe, about 30% of the world is neurodivergent. And when I use that term, neurodivergent, it includes all the communities, dyslexia, autism, ADHD, ADD, et cetera. All in, it's about 30%. So as a JPMorgan, it's kind of a global employer, and we are seeking, you know, an inclusive employer. We believe that about 30% of our staff are neurodivergent. So it's never a question of if we're going to have colleagues that process information differently. It's the question is, how many do you already have? And we're actively sourcing talent from these communities. So how many will you have in the very, you know, additional will you have in the very near future? I kind of view the neurodiversity space like this. It's one, there's nothing charitable about this. As a bank, a competitive bank, we want the very best talent for our firm. The unemployment rates or underemployment rates in the neurodiverse communities run, you know, autism could be 75-80%. IDD is probably closer to 90%. These are major untapped talent pools. And with some minor adjustments and accommodations to our processes and our workplace, we can enable these colleagues to come work here and be their very best and compel our business and also add and create, help create an amazing culture, amazing inclusive culture.
Right. So, Bryan, you just mentioned culture. So I have to ask about allyship, right? Because that seems to be a huge component. So how does JPMorgan Chase promote allyship in the workplace to support these neurodivergent employees and colleagues?
There's a couple of ways to look at this. I always start with a conversation around empathy. I think empathy is probably the single strongest manager attribute for a manager who will be, you know, successful at an inclusive work environment. So we start with empathy. And when we think about having colleagues or employees, if you're a leader that are maybe neurodivergent, and we'll put those we'll put neurodivergent in the category of kind of non-apparent disabilities, right? Colleagues don't need to tell us what their label is. They don't need to disclose if they're not comfortable. That's a very personal choice. But managers who lead with empathy think about everything from a needs-based perspective. So for example, if we have a new employee who may not identify as a member of the neurodivergent community, your conversation will be, welcome to JPMorgan Chase. What do you need to be your very best? You have a colleague who joins the first day and they may self-disclose as a member of one of the neurodivergent communities. Welcome to JPMorgan. What do you need to be your very best? It's the exact same conversation. Right. And leaders who lead with empathy, their job is always to come more than halfway across the table and make sure that the colleague has all the tools and resources they need to be their very best. And that view, of accommodations should be much more expansive for, the diverse communities we're sourcing talent from. So, for example, you have a neurodivergent colleague, they might have a preference for a seat location where there's less noise or distractions. They might have some, sensory or environmental accommodations they need. So maybe a seat near a window or where there's no traffic behind them. Colleagues from other communities like ADHD who organize their work a little differently. They might do 2 or 3 days of heavy intensive work where they get 5-7 days of work done, but then they might need a day of training or decompression where you adjust the intraday break schedules as well. So all of it is around, how do you provide the very best environment so colleagues get the support they need to be their very best when they come to work?
So Bryan, when we're talking about allyship, what we're really saying is, how do we remove those barriers to employment and the workspace generally? And so can you tell us a little bit more about JPMorgan Chase's advocacy work here? And can you give us an example of your commitment?
Yeah, we're operating on all fronts, both inside and outside of the firm. So I'll give you an example of advocacy. We realized early on when we were hiring colleagues from the IDD community, and again, it's intellectually and developmentally disabled, that many of them rely on Social Security benefits as a safety net for disability benefits. Unfortunately, the asset and income limits still in force for eligibility are decades old. I believe 1979.
Wow.
When we have colleagues here contributing to JP Morgan, we recognize our colleagues with salary increases and other compensation. We have colleagues who are protecting these outdated, working with these outdated asset and income limits. You can't have more than $2,000 in assets, which would include a 401k, free money from JPMorgan Chase. And the average is you can't make more than $1,380 a month. So when we recognize colleagues for their performance, they cut their hours back to ensure that they're mindful of those archaic asset and income limits to ensure they have their safety net. We published a policy brief last April, JPMorgan Chase taking a formal position that this is just unacceptable. Our colleagues can't pursue self-determination. They can't pursue their career aspirations. We are very fortunate that a couple of Ohio senators picked up on it and even referenced our policy brief in some legislation they're advancing to eliminate that savings penalty. They're out of Ohio, Portman and Brown. So that's an example of kind of operating outside of our walls, and that would certainly elevate the entire disability community, at least in the United States. In conjunction with that, we're working with other like-minded employers to include Microsoft, Bank of America, Capital One, Prudential, to name a number. Like-minded employers to create a group of employers to bring this forward as a paradigm shift that the equity issue is just as important, but decades old. We now have a business problem. As employers, we want access to the amazing talent in these communities, but this barrier to employment created by these asset and income limits, outdated asset and income limits, is problematic for us.
Bryan, you're hitting on something I want to drill down on even further, because it's something that we like to say at SIFMA often, is that a strong commitment to DEI isn't just the right thing to do, the moral thing to do. There's also a clear business imperative, as you've been kind of laying out for us. So can you share with us the value proposition of empowering neurodiverse individuals in the financial services industry and perhaps provide an example?
That's a great question. So I will absolutely unequivocally say this is good for business. There is a value proposition. Nothing about any of this work is charitable at all. We have a number, first, one, we want to be the employer of choice, but we also want to be the bank of choice for the neurodivergent and disability communities. So the first part of the equation is having representation from these communities, their diversity of thought, their lived experiences, their perspectives helps us understand how to provide products and services for the communities we want to bank. The second part of the equation is, and this is specific to the neurodivergent space, when you have colleagues that have a slightly different operating system and process information differently, and we'll call this a superpower, and are able to look at our old problems in new ways and new problems in new ways and provide a unique perspective on how we're conducting business, that is absolutely a competitive advantage. The third layer of this, and I'll give you a great example, is when we can match the superpower, neurodivergent superpower, to a specific transaction, that's where we really have, amazing outcomes, both empirically, and I'll talk a little bit more about cultural impacts. So here's a case study. We develop artificial intelligence as a firm, just like every other major enterprise does, and we have a data scientist that write the algorithms, and these return millions of data attributes. And you can't automate training the automation. So somebody has to review the values. And the 80% of them are in a high or low probability of match. So you're literally reviewing two data attributes. Do they match? Or two data attributes, do they not match? So our data scientists were doing this. It's iterative. It's not a good motivational fit. It doesn't align with their aspirations or how they perceive they add value. And when you have that poor motivational fit match with any type of transaction, you have bad outcomes. Terrible quality,
right?
Morale, attrition, attendance, all those things are byproducts. We decouple that part of the job and we matched a colleague from the neurodivergent community, or 10 colleagues actually from the neurodivergent communities, centric to IDD. And I'll give you one example. We have a colleague who is deeper in his autism spectrum. He's mostly nonverbal. The way he presents on the street, you probably wouldn't say he would do a great job working at JPMorgan on AI development. But we matched his talents to our business need through one of our support agencies. And his superpower is he stems on the process. His focus seems to renew each item. And he's done 60 plus thousand transactions and he has not made a mistake. That is an alignment of a superpower to a business need with an empirical outcome, and that is just amazing. But that's part. That's an example of the value proposition. We've been able to do this in a number of areas, five different lines of business, and we're entering our fourth major U.S. market for that program, the IDD-centered program, as we speak.
So, Bryan, I'm sitting here thinking, if I were another firm, where do I start, right? Where does the firm start in forming this ongoing diversity, equity, and inclusion strategy when it comes to neurodiversity, like you all have done and really spearheaded at JPMorgan? And how do you define success, right?
Yeah, I'll start with a success question and then I'll back into it. So success is when we have diversity of thought, diversity of lived experiences, diversity of perspectives integrated into all of the areas at the firm. There's often these kind of stereotypical roles associated with, I'll use autism as an example, that you think technology. Well, actually 60% of our autist colleagues are actually in operations and other roles outside of technology. So we don't limit ourselves, but it's about success is having representation across all areas of the firm. That's the first one. How do you do it? These programs started, I think, 6 years ago. And we did start small. We started with carve-outs. So you identify, a hiring manager who's kind of aligned with the concept, and they select a couple of jobs, and you use some, community partners or agencies to help match talent. And those agencies provide other supports like training and matching the talent to your business need, and they provide supports in that way. But you start small with carve-outs. But what I would encourage any company engaging in this space to do is to truly understand the inherent value and think about this less about, you need to, you might start with a program, but it needs to evolve to strategy. So I don't refer to any of our activities right. programs. These are integrated business strategies. And we think about ensuring that it's embedded in the ecosystem and not off the side of the desk. So here's a good example. We're not going to go out and have an autist hiring fair. We're going to have hiring fairs, and we're going to include autists, right? So
right,
it's integrated
exactly.
in how we conduct business. Yeah. And the disability community, including the neurodivergent community, is not a competing demographic with any other community. So all of our other work effort around, you know, like advancing Black pathways or veterans or LGBT plus, we have a lot of amazing work across the firm. We are an integrated demographic in every single one of those other spaces. And one of our major strategies is this kind of multi-integrated strategy where if one community is going to engage, you know, for hiring or for advocacy work, we add in layers and include the other areas. It's strategy, less about, starts off as programs, but it evolves to strategy.
So Bryan, it sounds to me like intersectionality is really critical here. Is
Absolutely
that right,
right,
in your opinion?
If we think about us separate and kind of, this word I'm using very loosely, but we're not a competing demographic. It's an integrated demographic into every all of the other great work the firm is doing. So absolutely, that's a crucial component.
That's incredible. So let's look toward the future, right? Where are the next opportunities to advance diversity, equity, and inclusion among neurodiverse individuals across the industry?
Yeah, we're looking at, we're moving on a couple of fronts. One, we want a stronger global presence. So we're working on scaling to all the regions. JPMorgan Chase, you know, is across the world. So that's one important component. And each region has its own unique operating model and challenges and opportunities. So we're working through that. We also want to have a stronger presence. We're working on advocating for disability-owned businesses, providing coaching, business coaching for entrepreneurs, founders that may be members of the neurodiverse community. It's another segment of our work. And then, as I mentioned earlier, we want to be the bank of choice. So we continue to push on why JP Morgan should be your first choice. We have accessible products. We're thinking about, you know, adding additional projects, products as we're informed by our internal communities to make sure that we're meeting the needs, the banking needs of the neurodivergent and disability communities. So growth, I would say growth. We have an amazing platform to scale from, but growth is my primary focus.
Wow. Well, I'm excited to see what you all do next. So let's close it out, Bryan. And what would you leave the listeners? What should they take away from this podcast, if you can think of one thing?
I want to everyone listening to this podcast to understand how the employment of these communities, it may feel like it's the right thing to do, and it is the right thing to do, but is the right thing to do for your business. And if you understand the value proposition and the power that these communities can bring to your firm with your superpowers, making a very intentional effort to be inclusive to this community will do nothing but yield benefit. And then culturally, the thing that I grossly underestimated about inclusion in these communities was the cultural impact. When team members, particularly with the IDD community, when team members step back and understand, you know, reflect on how I can be a supportive colleague, a supportive patient coach, when I think about leading with empathy, that tends to translate to the rest of the team. And we've seen team dynamics improve, less drama, less kerfuffles, and overall the health of the organization has been improved.
Wow. Bryan, thank you so much. We are so lucky to have you in your capacity at JP Morgan and as an advocate for these communities and all communities. So thank you for everything you're doing. Thank you for joining me today. It has been my pleasure. So to learn more about SIFMA's diversity, equity, and inclusion efforts, please, please visit sifma.org/diversity. Thank you to all of our listeners for tuning in to this incredible series. We hope you'll join us for our next episode of the SIFMA podcast. Thanks so much. Bye-bye.